as such, and also an amateur who wins a monetary sports prize. Surprisingly, they seem to exclude a former or injured sports person who is commentating on a broadcast as such. And probably that is because the income is not really earned from his performance in the field as a sports person, but he is earning it as a commentator. So he must be kind to the tribunal member, because he also has some material to rely on. That even the UN model also seems to suggest that a commentator does not participate. And in fact, we had a case like this. I don't know, for those of you who are following the IPL, about two seasons ago, we had a player called Brad Hogg from Australia, a left-arm spinner, and who was injured, and then he was in doing commentary for some time till I think somebody else got injured, and he actually started playing the IPL, and not only played, but he also continued for two more seasons of IPL, and is also playing the Big Bash in Australia, though he's about 43-44 years. So this is not an illustrative, only an academic situation. It can happen. But the simple point here is that as long as he is earning from the performance on the field, that is taxable and under articles and not otherwise. Streams of income, I think I have put this down here. I think this is more or less very similar to the circular that we saw, 787. And therefore, I will not go through that in great detail, but I've just given some illustrations. For example, sponsorship, merchandising income, you've seen that. People wearing Nike logos and Adidas logos and things like that. Probably there is often controversy about where the logos are displayed and whether the logo display is probably more prominent. And you had also certain sportsmen actually being restricted from using other brand names. For example, I think once Sachin Tendulkar used to use the MRF logo on a bat very significantly, and I think when he changed his contract, then again MRF is restricted, saying that we have rights to a particular thing. So anything that he earns as a result of the performance, of course he is not a non-resident sportsman, but if there was someone who used a non-resident sportsman and that was prominently earned, if to the extent it is attributable to the activity in India. Now that is very important to note, that if you have some kind of income which is a consistent stream of income, and then you come into India and you perform on a particular place, if there is evidence to show that there is directly relatable to the period which the activity or the sports event was held in India, then it is taxable in India. But if it is an ongoing period, then clearly it is not taxable fully in India. Only a portion of the activity which is attributable will be taxable in India. Income from combined activities, as I mentioned, Clint Eastwood, for those of you who are fans of this great Western star, used to act in a lot of Western movies, Good, Bad, the Ugly, Hang Them High, For a Few Dollars More, all those. And he's also become a very famous director now, a film director, and has produced great movies, all Oscar winning movies. Now very often he acts and he directs, and so therefore the question is, what happens in a relation to a combined activity? Clearly the commentary seems to suggest that only to the extent of his performance as an actor or as an entertainer that it will be taxed, not as a director. Of course it will be tough in order to attribute or to apportion this amount between the two kinds of incomes as such. Some broad tests on the streams of income, and how do you ascertain a connection with the performance, because as I said, that becomes very crucial. What is the timing of the income generating event? If a payment is made in relation to an event, then it clearly gets captured. If it is a payment made after the event or pre the event, then it may not get really captured as such. So in short, what is very, very important, therefore, is if you look at 115 BBA, what you look at the article relation 17 in relation to that, the contract is very, very important. And if it is a regular source of income, the regular stream of income, not connected only to the activity in India, but say to an activity which takes place where a person has to perform both in India and in neighboring countries, then again the income will have to be apportioned, because under section 911 as well as a treaty, will be able to tax only that income which is connected to the activity in India. Activity outside India is clearly not accruing in India and therefore not taxable as such. some instances of income not covered under Article 17. I won't take you through that. As I said, I can see that it is nearing 5:30, and I'm sure that you have spent a lot of time today. I don't want to bore you with unnecessary and mundane details. They are all available in the paper book that I have given. 17.2. What does Article 17.2 contain? And we saw 17.1, which describes the activities of the sportsman, what can be taxed, what is included, what is not included, who is an artist, who is a sportsman. All that we looked at 17.1, and we also looked at in 17.1 that India or the source, the country of the source, has a right to tax, and that Articles 7, 14 and 15 are irrelevant. So those are the basic principles of 17.1. Now let's come back to 17.2, which is the second main article in this, and that is basically an anti-avoidance provision. And what it normally says is that the income in relation to the export, the personal activities does not accrue as such to the entertainer or to a sports person, but to another person as such, then notwithstanding whatever Article 7, 14, 15 may say, they may be taxed in the contracting state in which the activities of the entertainer or sports person are exercised. So this is an anti-avoidance provision. What they want to say is that they know that we are all very smart. Indians are known for the jugaad as such. Even something like a demonetization, people say that jugaad has ensured that demonetization doesn't affect anyone as such. So similarly here, people will say, okay, I'll pay you only 5-10% here, but I will pay to some company which you are a part of, and that could be, in tax parlance, it is called a star company. So it is called a company which is, say, suppose Glenn Maxwell Private Limited or Glenn Maxwell Limited, or whatever be the name that you want to say, Stephen Smith Limited, and we will make a payment to you, and then we will try and contend that this is not, we are making a payment to that particular entity, we are not making a payment to Stephen Smith. Only Stephen Smith's payments are covered as per Article 17, and therefore it will escape taxation altogether. And it is with a view to try and overcome such a kind of an arrangement of a star company that you have this article which is brought in 17.2, which says that if the activity, the amount is payable very clearly for the performance of a sporting activity in India, irrespective to who that amount is paid, whether it is company or any other company or whatever it is, doesn't matter, that amount is still taxable in the hands of the sports person or the entertainer as such, to that extent possible, and it is taxable under Article 70. And you may note that not only in India, but in all other countries and all other sportsmen have had this problem, where sports people, it looks as if they are greedy world over. Not only in India, it's not only that Indians, that we often say that, you know, people are not wanting to pay taxes. Because if you look at Steffi Graf, her father went to prison because for all the tennis tournaments that were held, all the European people, you know, taxes are very high. They were paying to some tax haven country, one company which was formed, the German authorities found it, Mr. Peter Graf was put in jail as a result of that. You look at Messi, Lionel Messi is also facing problems, same type of problems, that Barcelona, the company for which he pays for paid monies, his father, and he had to appear in court, again payment to some star companies, and probably payments outside the books, because payment made to them X amount, payment Y amount, they are facing problem. Neymar is also another case. He is also facing challenges because payments made to Neymar, the Brazilian authorities are saying, have not been offered to tax. So this 17.2 is a anti-avoidance provision which was largely brought in order to ensure, as I have said here, that if the amount is not paid to the individual but to a star company that is typically registered in a tax haven, even that becomes taxable under Article 17 and does not escape taxation. We then move on to some of the exclusions. In the exclusions, here I have highlighted something which has been mentioned by the OECD commentary, which is prize money of the owner of a horse or a car that does not relate to the personal activity. As I mentioned earlier, the entire emphasis of the thrust of the section is on the personal activities and the performance of the individual per se, and not on ownership per se. So if a horse owner is getting his horse run in a particular derby or whatever it is, the Mahalakshmi Race Course Cup, and he comes in and he runs that horse and he earns the money, then that amount is really not taxable in his hands, as such as it is not performance per se of a sports person. Similarly, if you have paid monies to an agent, which was the case also of Wizcraft, where they wanted a couple of popular music artists to come to India, if they paid monies to a particular agent, I think the name was Colin Davis, if I am not mistaken, and Colin Davis in turn contacted four or five different agents of the artists and was able to ensure a show where a whole group of artists came in and performed in India. Now, the tax department tried to argue that this was related to the performance. So Colin Davis said, no, I really don't have anything to do with the performance. My contract was limited to the fact that they asked me to procure these people. Wizcraft had no idea who these people were. I got into touch with all the managers and agents of these various artists. And the amount also was, of course, a reasonable amount. I think it was only $50,000 or so. You can't have suddenly, you know, something disguised as half the compensation that you pay to the artist, and you say, I have paid only for the purpose of his actually getting those people together. So amount was also reasonable, and therefore tribunal agreed that this was nothing but for actually getting them all together and was not related to the performance of the artist in India, and therefore neither 18, there was article 18.1 or 18.2 will really not apply. Some Indian AAs or treaties, there is a little bit of a departure. I don't think we should bother about that. As I said, for each and every practical case that you are going to be looking at, you will have to look at what that article suggests, article 17 or 18 as the case may be, as we see here in the US, for example, we said that 17.2 or 18.2 is an anti-avoidance provision, and if the amount is paid to a company, then even then it is taxable in India as relating to the entertainer. But US has a provision which says that income accrued to another person will not be taxed if the entertainer or the artist, etc., is able to establish that they, neither the persons who participate directly or indirectly in the profits of the person, or by way of deferred remuneration, bonuses, fees, dividends, partnership distribution, or others. So that seems to place a lot of emphasis on the artist. If he says, okay, you are paying to company B, but I am not a star company, that's not really my company, then please try and establish that you are not either an owner, you don't own any kind of equity stake in it, you're not going to get any deferred remuneration from it, bonuses, distributions. Once you establish that kind of the onus, then the anti-avoidance provision in 18.2 does not get triggered. So 18.2 is separately worded in the India-USA, is all that I wanted to highlight. Otherwise, 18.2 normally puts the onus on the taxpayer by saying, if you are paying to another any other person for the activities of the performer or the sportsman, then it is taxable in India. 17.3 sometimes provides an exception to 17.2.1 and 2, and that is largely if the amounts for the performance are funded by a public authority or a municipal authority or whatever it is. Then if it is coming from public funds, then there is a clause to try and exempt the payment which is made under section 17, article 17, sorry, and this forms place in the form of article 73 in most DTAAs. If you remember, when once Michael Jackson had come to India and performed at the Andheri Sports Complex, probably it was organized by a wing of the Shiv Sena, not by a public fund. But say, suppose if BMC was to become generous and organize it, maybe if public funds for that particular purpose, then I think